Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the fifth webinar in the series of webinars which the Grant Thornton Not-for-Profit and CSR Advisory Group has brought to you since May of 2020. The COVID-19 pandemic has really sort of shifted everybody's immediate focus, only to the health emergency. And hence, we thought that today we should bring to all of you, something which is refreshingly different, and bring to you views of a very eminent panel on the key aspects of governance and monitoring of CSR programs. And also kind of analyze to see that would these tools program assessments, partner evaluations, audits, etc., have the same importance in the minds of management as well as key stakeholders. So it gives me really great pride and pleasure to welcome a very, very eminent and very diverse panel. Today we have a CEO of a large foundation. We also have a chief regulatory officer. We have a regional director, and we have a chief financial officer. So I think we will have an absolutely exciting discussion, and I am really looking forward to it. So welcome, a very, very warm welcome from Grant Thornton to the panel. I would like to shortly introduce Arun Pandey, who is the Region Citizenship Director at John Deere. Arun actually has a passion for the social sector, and his current responsibilities include giving leadership direction to John Deere's CSR strategy and execution in India, China, Africa, and Southeast Asian countries, Institute of Social Sciences. It gives me a great pleasure to welcome P. Balaji, who is the Chief Regulatory and Corporate Affairs Officer of Vodafone India Limited since 31st of August 2018. Prior to this, he held a similar position at Vodafone and has in the past been the Managing Director of Nokia India and of Sony Mobile. He is also an electronics engineer from IIT Roorkee and an MBA from IIM Ahmedabad. It really gives me a lot of pleasure also to welcome Sandeep Batra, who is the Chief Financial Officer at Crompton Greaves Consumer Electricals Limited. Sandeep is a chartered accountant and company secretary, and he's worked with ICI for 21 years before he moved to Pidilite as their CFO, and then joined Crompton Greaves Consumer Electricals as CFO in 2015. A very warm welcome also to the CEO at JSW Foundation. Ashwini has postgraduate degrees in geology, business management, and CSR leadership from the University of Geneva. And his experience has ranged from UNIDO, IFC, to heading the CSR operations of the SR Group in Zimbabwe and consequently in India. Welcome once again to the panelists. In terms of the structure of the discussion today, we will first have each of the panelists give their opening comments as to how they consider these assessments as tools which have actually helped them in their existing role. Post the opening comments from each of the panelists, we will have a panel discussion. Then we will take question and answers from the audience on the chat box and pose them to the various panelists as applicable. So welcome all. And I'd first like to pose my question to Ashwini. So Ashwini, if you can give your opening comments and tell the audience a little bit about, you know, how some of these assessments, project audits, etc., impact assessments have helped you in your current role as the CEO of JSW Foundation.
So thank you so much for giving me the opportunity. It's my, I would say, honor to be a part of this eclectic panel. I think, you know, our JSW Foundation actually looks after the CSR operations for the JSW Group, which is like a quite a diversified conglomerate, as I would say. And therefore, we have been working across the length and the breadth of the country, and which also has therefore given us the opportunity to see the same kind of, you know, sectoral issues panning out, manifesting themselves in a very different manner in different geographies. So the way, water would be looked at, say, in Himachal would be very different in the way water would be looked at as an issue in some, in a place like Barmer. And so on. Similarly, you know, within South India, where we have a huge, significant presence in terms of our work, how across the coastal areas of Konkan and Ratnagiri area, how there itself, you know, from one location to the other, the programs and the nature of the programs changes. And therefore, obviously, you know, when you have to work as an organization trying to, you know, meet the requirements of the community so diversified and so spread out, at each place you have to nurture partnerships, because alone, you know, you cannot be contributing into this ecosystem development. And so therefore, the first challenge that comes is that, you know, you have to look at partners who are very relevant to that particular context, not just in terms of their sectoral competence, but also in terms of their understanding about the local culture, the local milieu, which is so important, you know, for carrying out activities. And therefore, thankfully, with Rohit's team, with Grant Autumn, we've come up with this model where we are doing an impact, you know, where we're doing an evaluation of each partner of ours in three different categories. So first is that we are looking at, you know, the programs that are being done for the existing partners, how those programs have, you know, shaped, and if, you know, we measure them on the efficiency and the efficacy and the impact part of it. That's one. So that's largely program assessment. Typically, we can qualify it as an impact assessment. The second part that we work on is on the financial systems and the internal systems that the organization possesses. And I think this is where we do a lot of, you know, due diligence of what kind of internal systems processes are being adhered to by this organization, so that we are very sure as a, I would say, partner slash donor, that the funds are being utilized in a proper way and they do have the right kind of governance in place, which is going to help this organization deliver for what it has approached us. And the third component, which I think is picking up in a big way, is that we also look at the regulatory compliance of the organization. Sometimes, you know, ignorance, they say ignorance is bliss, but sometimes this bliss can turn into a big disaster. So what we have done is, the third component that we are working on is, we are also doing a regulatory assessment of each organization. Many a times, small organizations, small partner institutions are not even aware of the kind of compliances that they have to adhere to. And so therefore, we get into the details of the various kind of assessments that need to be taken care of, what kind of regulatory compliances they have to adhere to. Because steadily and slowly and steadily, I think, you know, the way the lens of human rights is coming into this social development space, CSR space especially, the responsibility of the institution, which is at the higher end of the spectrum, so to say, has the primary responsibility of ensuring that all the partners down the line, literally or down the line, should be, you know, compliant with various kinds of laws and regulations. And if they are not, it kind of reflects badly upon the main institution also. So with JSW's presence and JSW's, you know, big reputation, brand image, it's very important for us to, you know, make sure that what kind of institutions are we partnering with, and are they abreast with what they need to adhere to in terms of their own regulatory compliances. So I think this is the third piece, which is very important and which we are working. And therefore, you know, if you ask me, the kind of budgets that we spend, the kind of, you know, activities that we are into, for us, it's a very important thing, you know, to have the social license to operate. Being a core sector company into steel and power and different kind of sectors, it's important for us to make sure that we adhere to the requirements which are local as well as national and global. So on one hand, we adhere to these SDGs, every single, so we have a very, I would say, a fairly well-designed monitoring and evaluation system, which kind of picks up every single indicator at the grassroots level and connects it directly or indirectly to one of the SDGs that we're talking about. So for all the SDGs, which are the SDGs which are pertinent to our work, out of those, which are the targets that we can actually be addressing to. So we are tagging each line of, you know, thing to that. And this this understanding that we are a part of the larger ecosystem and we have to make our small, you know, small little humble contribution to the whole larger picture. I think that's where, you know, bringing in the organizations with whom you are partnering also abreast is also very important. So in fact, there's a thought process that's going on in foundation today. Just I finished off my advisory board meeting where we are saying that, you know, CSR is just a tool. It's not the end means. The end means is the overall social development. And JSW Foundation, to play a change maker's role, needs to look at the larger ecosystem development. So while we've been strengthening our own internal systems and processes, in the process of doing that, what we've realized is that there's a lot of input, thanks to these partner assessments that we've done with Grant Thornton, that we are able to give advice and handhold these partner institutions. So they are able to also identify where are they lacking in terms of regulatory compliances, which they were perhaps unfortunately not even aware of, or what are the things in terms of their financial systems which can be improved upon. So from that lens, you know, I would say impact assessments is just one part of your program. So the money that you put in, what has come out of it, that's just one small little component of it. But we as organizations who are at the forefront of developing this ecosystem along with the governments, it's important for us to see that how we, you know, build the capacities of the institutions around, not just by giving them grants, but by helping them understand what all is it required for them internally and externally. So if that internal and external alignment is taken care of by each individual organization, together as partners, we become really good, you know, partners in the development space. And this ecosystem, if it develops, today it is helping JSW Foundation, tomorrow it may help another foundation or another corporate. And vice versa, we may also benefit by the capacity building of the organizations that has been done by other organizations. I think, so I would end here. So as a foundation, we are into a number of programs and therefore partners are very important for us. And we work with some of the partners like, you know, who are attached to the UN system like ICRISAT, to the grassroots level organizations who are working with us on mangrove restoration in a place like, say, Raigad district of Maharashtra. So a whole range of partners work with us, and therefore it's important for us to, you know, pass on the best practices from one side to the other. I'll stop here.
Great. Thank you so much, Ashwini, for your view and, you know, on the takeaway that, you know, there could be a potential capacity building, which would, you know, not only be of benefit to you as a group and as a foundation, but also to, you know, the entire development sector at large. I'd like to next request, you know, Mr. Sandeep Batra. Sandeep, sir, it'll be great to get a CFO's view. I'm really sure. Excited to have you here. Because I very rarely do you find discussions like these, being joined by CFOs. So I, you know, it's actually a real pleasure to have you here with us.
Sure. So thanks, Rohit, so much for inviting me. And when I got the invite, I was wondering why me. I know we had we worked with Grant Thornton on this particular area. But then I figured out maybe it is because of maybe my passion for this subject. Let me try and address your this question by kind of tracing the history of Crompton and CSR. Crompton, as the consumer electrical entity as we are, is quite young. We are not even 5 years old. And this business, which has a rich legacy, was formed out of a demerger in 2015. So bank, 1st October 2015, new entity was created. There were a few changes to the management team. And we all got down to work. And soon, 6-9 months later, we figured out that, as a company now, you have to also take care of CSR because there is a corporate requirement of certain amount of spend. So we were lucky because we had no history. In the first year, you had no obligation to spend. There was no prior 3 years of profit. But that got us thinking as a company, what is it that we want? What are we looking at? I mean, is it just about meeting a 2% commitment of contribution, or is it much more? And we said, look, all of us have day jobs. None of us have time for it. So let's look at hiring a professional who will help at least evolve the CSR strategy for the company. So we went out, we got a professional, asked him. That gentleman was committed to CSR because it was, in some sense, his passion. And I took on that responsibility because CSR was also my passion. And we put together a strategy framework in place. This gentleman went around all our factories, understood what the local requirements were, looked at what may, work in the overall context of Crompton, spoke to the directors, and our CSR strategy was formed. And we were up and running 2016. So we onboarded a few, we had chosen two focus areas. One being skill, the other being water conservation. Skill also was narrowed. It was not, any skill that we would help support. It was all around mechanical, electrical, plumbing trades, and water conservation. And work started. So we identified a few skill development partners who started creating centers where we would impart training on mechanical, these MEP trades. And one fine day, this gentleman comes in and tells us that, look, I've got another role. So I don't think I'll be able to continue as your advisor. We said, oh, so what are we going to do? Our advisor is gone. So, then we figured out that, maybe it's not a good idea to rely on one individual as an advisor. Why not look at a firm who does this kind of advisory, who kind of helps put systems, processes in place. So we tied up with one CSR advisory firm who would do two things. One, they were like the bridge between all these NGOs on one hand and the corporates on the other. Corporates had money, NGOs had ideas, and these guys kind of acted as the bridge, but also helped do a lot of the background work around due diligence of the NGO, making sure that their project was aligned. And we started that work. So that was about, that went on for, I think, about 12, 18 months. And then our board suggested to us that, look, you've done a pretty decent job in terms of CSR from zero to one individual advisor to now a firm. Now, why don't you get somebody else to do an audit of all the investments and all the work that you have done, and make sure that you are getting the right bang for the buck. And actually, all the expenditure or all the outlay that you are doing is actually having an impact. So that was the first time, quite honestly, we figured out that, yes, somebody has to do impact assessment. Because otherwise, the only impact assessment I had heard of was this environment impact assessment that you would do either when you are doing an acquisition or, which you hear about when new projects are being launched. So we got Grant Thornton in, and Grant Thornton did an outstanding job. And in fact, they opened for us so many fronts that were kind of blind spots for us. It was not that we had deliberately omitted it. It was just that when corporates run CSR with people who are having day jobs, everybody will look at it from a very, very from his own individual perspective. So nobody looks at it from a CSR perspective, because when we looked back after the work that was done, on this whole assessment, we found two areas which were absolute blind spots for us, and which we realized could have, you know, significantly tarnished the name of the corporation, and B, could have taken away from the whole purpose of what we were spending money for. One was what Ashwini addressed earlier, which is all about regulatory compliance. Now, are you ensuring that the NGO partner has taken all due approvals? You know, we were sponsoring money for doing nala widening, for doing well sinking, and we never checked whether it was on land which the NGO had authority to do work on. Maybe it was government land and this guy was trespassing. So we didn't know, and this audit and this review by Grant Thornton actually threw it open that, hey, I think, you know, and ultimately it will be Crompton as the sponsor whose name will get tarnished. So this was a big revelation for us. And the second revelation was that, you know, in our skill development initiative, we had one metric: how many people are getting placed. So we had a target, 80% getting placed. And, you know, being number people, we would make sure that 80% of those guys would get placed. But what happens to them after 1 year? That perspective wasn't there. So I think this whole getting a third party, getting a professional perspective of all the work that you are doing on CSR is 100% required, irrespective of the maturity of the organization. We were maybe 4 year young company, but I can bet you I worked for 30 years. All these things missed my notice. So certainly, I think these kind of studies and interventions have allowed us now to include many more aspects in the way we evaluate the program, both before the commitment as well as a measure of the effectiveness of the program. So that's all I had to say, Rohit. Over to you.
Thank you so much for that, Sandeep. And I would now request, you know, Balaji, sir, you know, Balaji, I know that, you know, you have a greater portfolio in addition to CSR. And that has been, you know, since, you know, even before the merger with IDEA. So it would be great to hear, you know, your views at, with the portfolio that you carry, and, you know, with the fact that you're part of the national leadership team, as to how, you know, some of these aspects have helped you in communicating with the board and, you know, with your other stakeholders.
Thank you very much, Rohit. And I think we've heard a fantastic set of two speakers already on this panel, you know, throw a lot of light on the topic. I guess, if I just step back a little bit for our own organization, whether it's the Vodafone Group or the ABG Group, giving and the whole thing about larger societal good is extremely high on the agenda of both the groups and also the entire leadership team of Vodafone Idea. Therefore, we are undertaking a lot of transformative CSR projects, and these are in multiple areas of education, women empowerment, financial literacy, agriculture. And in each of these, the one thing that we figured out is that whatever you do has to come from core to what the strength of the organization is. And therefore, for us, technology and scale is an element that we deploy a lot. In other words, using technology for good, which is a broader objective, but doing that with the thing that technology allows us to scale is something that we are therefore very consciously deploying as part of our implementation strategy. And to this effect, what we also do is that we realize that, as in the telecom space, ecosystems is what creates maximum impact, same for reach and scale. So in our own way, we make our effort to make sure that whatever we do has the entire ecosystem of state and central government, as well as social sector, playing into the whole solving of large social issues in the areas that I mentioned above. And so that's the broader picture that we kind of always follow. And clearly, in the context of whether something is in the CSR Act or not, because giving has been part of our entire culture, you know, whether it's the group or ABG or the company itself. We say that if you cannot measure something, you cannot improve. And that's true for business, that's true for social venture as well, or our foundation work. And so what we do is we deploy a lot of rigor and measurement techniques for two specific things. One is to make sure that in the course of implementation of the projects, if there's any mid-course correction, we can do that. Second is the end of the project to demonstrate to ourselves that the ROI, the social ROI that we wanted to execute and get for the project that we're implementing, has that happened or not? And so therefore, from our point of view, what you've asked is a very pertinent question of program assessments is something which is very, very high on our agenda. And we kind of follow through a hybrid means of digital now, even more now. We used to do that before as well. But a hybrid process of using digital and physical means to do multiple things. Number one, making sure that the MIS system for each of the projects are robustly in place, transparently through the layers that we need to go through. So if there's a state government intervention in one dimension, or if there is two or three other social sector partners that are working on a financial literacy program on which we reach about 10 million people on an annualized basis, then we have to make sure that we can actually, in the end, measure and track the beneficiaries and the impact to them. So demonstrating ourselves that the entire MIS system cuts through the various layers of implementation till the end beneficiary is something very critical for us. Likewise, as I said, we use multiple partners because we think that partnership is the way to grow impact. And in that case, concurrent measurement and monitoring of project implementation across various channels of implementation is something that we very strongly focus on. Besides that, there's a cadence that we follow. This is very dear to our heart, and it's something that my entire foundation team, Nile, who heads our foundation, and his entire team, is, and me personally and our board is extremely keen to see, is that we do programs from a project rigor of reviews on a weekly basis, on a monthly and a quarterly basis. The intent of these is not just to monitor things, but the intent is to move the agenda forward. Sometimes, and I think Ashwini spoke about capacity building, yeah, and I think that's important. If we do not participate in the capacity building of people, then it will not work. The implementation partners need to feel that ownership. Likewise, for us, it's a learning tool. We think things will work in a particular way, and suddenly, the field responses come totally different, and it requires for us to sit with our partners and figure out, my God, this is not working the way it is supposed to. What mid-course correction do we need? And so these reviews are not from the point of view of control, but it's actually in the context of saying, how do we make sure that we are engaged in the whole journey of co-creation of the idea which we've done with the partners, but is the execution working to the initial idea that we started with, or do we need to make mid-course correction? And of course, third-party assessment with whether it's leading players like you guys and Grant Thornton or other organizations that do the baseline, midline, and endline. All of these are very critical. What we've also therefore got to your point, Rohit, is to make sure that the visibility of each of these is something that goes all the way to the CSR board on an ongoing basis. We have a Section 8 company, so we have that itself has its own board structure. Besides the donors, we make sure that the donor, in our case, that's Vodafone Idea or other donors that bring us money in, we make sure that their board also has full visibility of the impact that is creating for the rupees or monies that they're contributing to us. And the one other thing that we actually did, since we believe that technology can help not just ourselves, but also other social sector partners, we've actually looked at ways of creating small but important values. We created a program management tool called Manager. And it's something that we work with other social sector partners to create. The benefit of what we are doing here is not just for ourselves. Of course, we are making sure that we do it. NASSCOM Foundation, which worked very closely with us in that journey, has implemented Manager as a tool. Because we figured out, hey, we do things on Excel, we do things on email, we do things on paper, can we actually put that whole thing together in a meaningful manner where it is empowering to the program manager and the implementation people, not as adding headache to them, but it's easing their ability to implement on the ground. And the beauty of this whole thing is now this manager tool, which has been created with that outlook, is now being freely available to other smaller organizations that cannot afford to get that kind of IT tool possibly. The larger companies in any case have wonderful tools they want to use, or they've developed, or they in fact have strong assessment programs. But for the smaller ones that want to have the same rigor, which I think was talked about by earlier speakers on regulatory compliance and so on, that they are absolutely on top of the game, is something that we have started to also offer, because that's our way of giving back something to this process that we've learned over years. Requires a lot of understanding, empathy, and a ruthless updation of all the rules and regulations as well. With that, I hand it back to you, Rohit.
Yeah, so very interesting point, Balaji, and I think I've already learned from this session, and I had never thought beyond governance and control. For the impact assessment and evaluation exercise. So you married what Ashwini has mentioned, and brought about a very important point that yes, these tools can actually be used for capacity building as well. So I think that's that's like an amazing point for all of us. Thank you so much for that. With that, I move on to Arun sir. Arun, you have a global role, right? So you go from country to country. They have these different dynamics. So please do give your opening comments. In the context of the global role.
Rohit, can you hear me?
Absolutely.
Yeah. So thank you, Rohit, and very good afternoon to the all panelists and 251 participants who have joined this through virtual. So just to give you some rich history of Deere, so we are 182 years old company, and we have basically three line of business. So that's agriculture and turf, construction, forestry, and road equipment, and then we have our John Deere Finance. In India also, we have a very rich history. We are a 20 plus years old company. We have a three manufacturing plant, a big technology center at Pune, and a large employee base. Now, as we are a kind of a global company, we basically focus on three key themes. So just before I start on themes, want to give you perspective that how much Deere gives importance to its citizenship program. We have this inbuilt as a part of our strategy. Like in business strategy, we have all the metrics defined. So same way the civic and environmental stewardship is very clearly defined. So in line with that, we focus on three themes. One is basically, how do we provide solutions for world hunger? So how do we make the farmers more increase in their agriculture productivity? How we increase their income? Then the second piece, what we focus in terms of education programs, that how do we inspire students to attend higher learnings? And community development basically program ensures that how do we ensure basic services for most needy community. So all these programs have a very clear cut question zero. And I think question zero is a very important concept. So what this concept basically does? So this concept says that when all of your stakeholders answer in the same language, anything what you want to do it, it means there is a clear cut clarity and visibility for that. Say for an example, in Solutions for World Hunger program, the John Deere and the partners, we have a very clear cut metrics that we are going to empower farmers to increase their agriculture productivity and income. So this is a single metrics what we try to track across each programs. So if we do program in Africa, if we do program in India or say Southeast Asia, this is a single clear cut metrics we have. Of course, the baseline indicators define the parameters what we want to achieve. But once you have a clear cut what you want to achieve, you can outline all other tools in the place. some of a very key foundational approach what we use across all our CSR programs. So John Deere has a very rich history of doing citizenship programs or CSR programs, not only in India before the rules came, but long back we have been doing it. So some of the approach what we follow across our programs that all the panelists mentioned, the importance of identifying a not-for-profit partner. Because we feel that CSR program is not just establishing an infrastructure, but it's delivering goods and services. And to deliver the goods and services, you need an expert. Like for business, you have an expert. Say for CSR also, you need an expert. It's no longer a generalist job. So in that way, we identify not-for-profit partners who basically work us right from the need assessment to implement the programs and then monitor and measure it programs. The other things also in our approach, what we basically adopt is a long-term approach of a development programs. 2 years, 1 year, just doing an output activity is good. But then is it important to have a long-term view? Because if you want to work with the community, you want to empower, you want to change their behaviors and process, you need a long-term view of that. So for all our development programs, I think we follow a very long-term view of that. Also, we have a clear-cut outcome theory of change. So that defines why you are doing what you are doing and how you are going to measure it. Because unless that is clear right from the start of the program, your programs will basically, you can have a very good tool to measure it midterm or end term. But if there is no clarity from the beginning, that things are not going to process. So these are the kind of beautiful approaches what we have adopted across all our programs. Now, if I turn how this approach and how our sincerity has translated in terms of using, because it's very important that what you do, that basically should help you to make further decisions. So I look at monitoring or impact measurement as a kind of a radar to a ship. So if ship has a radar, you know that where it's going. Otherwise, it's a directionless. You can go in any direction and there will not be any impact. So all these evaluations, assessments, either end line or baseline, they basically help you to guide in which direction you want to go and how you want to go. And also, I would suggest that in terms of my experience, the way we look at John Deere, that we have a very open culture of learning within the partner. That is why we don't call ourselves as a donor or the NGO as a kind of recipient. We call them partners. Because when you have a partnership principle, it means that you have an equal stake at the table. So you can discuss what's your learning. You can also talk about failure. Because most of the time, I think in development sector, we all talk about the success in terms of metrics and other things, but we never talk about the failure. It's very important developmentally to talk about failures, learn from your mistakes, and also provide an opportunity to innovate. So keeping in line with that philosophy, I think John Deere also invests in the organizational development of the NGO partners. Because if you don't have a human capital to deliver your programs, you are not going to achieve outcome how beautifully you have laid out or how beautifully you plan to measure it. So with having a clear cut what we want to measure it and with a very clear cut metrics that how we are going to use it to re-evaluate our programs, look at a long term, this is how we implement our CSR programs across the board. Of course, Rohit, to your questions that we since we are a global company, we have a multiple geographies, but these metrics doesn't change. So we call it like our foundational success factors for any development programs. So irrespective whether you are doing a citizenship project in India or Africa, I think these are kind of non-negotiables. It doesn't change. However, we also give an opportunity for the partner to innovate and make decisions within the local geography and context.
Wow, that's wonderful, Arun. So another very interesting aspect that, don't just look at impact assessment as a tom-tomming tool, right? It can also be used very effectively to learn, from some of, potential failures. So thank you so much for that. I would like to ask, you know, Ashwini, sir, you had alluded on, you know, some of the aspects of, you know, partner evaluation, etc. You know, knowing the way JSW is structured, etc., there are multiple stakeholders. So if you can throw some light on how these various stakeholders view these evaluation exercises. I mean, it could be good or bad, etc., but it would be very interesting to know what the promoters think, what you at the foundation level think, what are the plant level kind of concerns, etc. So please share with the group, you know, a perspective of how different people view these exercises.
Sure. Thanks, Rohit. First of all, let me tell you that foundation, like typically, you know, JSW Foundation also was, you know, instituted many, many years ago. I mean, we completed about 30 years last year. And skill development and I would say vocational education for women and women BPO. These are three things, you know, which were achieved to a great extent even before 2005, if I may say so. So the first skill development center was established way back somewhere in the year 2001. And first women BPO, an activity which we are very proud of, a program that we are very proud of, was somewhere in 2004 when it was established. So you know, what I'm trying to say is that, you know, understanding that, yes, these kind of connects need to be made. And, you know, your social license to operate, your sharing your... I would say sharing your resources and sharing your capacities with the communities around. I think that that becomes a very important part. But as you know, you would see most organizations have evolved. As CSR budgets have gone up, as you know, the compliance part has crept into CSR. Therefore, you know, a lot of reporting back to the government, making sure that you are on the right side of the law for everything. I think all those compulsions have started coming in. And so therefore, at the top end, I would say, you know, while the promoters have been into, you know, CSR / philanthropy, charity, whatever word we may use, you know, there's a whole lot of 40, 45 words in the jargon attached to CSR. But, and there are not very, I would say, very finer differences between one and the other. So, you know, while they have continued to do, you know, all that support work and, you know, a lot of art and heritage restoration work also has been done because the chairperson, Mrs. Jindal, has been very, you know, passionate about it. But the fact is that this understanding that, yes, have we done sufficient enough? I think that is one lens with which the promoters tend to look at it. The next layer, you know, where the companies, JMDs and DMDs and all the CEOs of different group companies, incidentally, foundation has to, you know, work closely with 24 group companies, big and small. So you can imagine each one has very different expectations and their local social context is also very different. So they would obviously like to have, you know, CSR, you know, support them in that particular initiative, in that particular manner. So therefore, there's a whole range of, I would say, expectations, you know, which come up. But by and large, if I would like to put them into buckets, first one is, are we doing sufficient enough? Which is one part which comes from top down, I would say. The second part is, what is it that we can do differently? So that's the second way of measuring that. Okay, so like, which I think Mr. Balaji also touched upon that, you know, can you compare between program A and program B and which one is more suited to this local requirement? That's the second level. And the third component which comes up both from the plant management as well as, you know, from I would say the top management of the group companies is that can you do it more cost effectively, or can you increase your outreach more? I mean, so you know, getting maximum bang for the buck. I think that's the third lens with which people look at it. And I think the expectations that we are trying to, you know, nurture for ourselves so that we get, you know, more and more strategic in our approach, is that of late we have started looking at direct working with the communities, not even working with the partner institutions, but directly working with the communities. And we started working on this model in a couple of locations. And I would say we're just 6 months down the line. So I can't say that we have been successful or unsuccessful, But yes, this is an experiment that we are trying to do where, you know, and it all comes from this philosophy that, you know, ultimately it's the key beneficiaries, the key stakeholders who need to, you know, we always talk about, you know, community led and community managed and community, you know, supported programs. But how do you do that? Because, you know, community remains a nebulous entity if you don't go and organize them. So off late, what we have started doing is that at a couple of locations, even the organizations with whom we want to partner for a particular program, their primary responsibility is not towards us because we are only giving resources, financial resources, but they actually have to deliver the results to the community. So therefore, the communities are being organized and the communities are being brought in, and we are doing a lot of work with the Gram Panchayats now, believing that till we do not work on the local governance framework and don't strengthen it, we would always be talking about matrices of measurement of work and improving upon it within our, you know, four walls. And till this is not well understood by the communities for whom you are doing this, there is no point, you know, beyond a point to do this work. So we are working on this model where we're trying to see how they themselves perceive the work. How are they getting engaged? So for a lot of agricultural programs, now rather than we giving resources to the partner organization, we are doing a kind of a reimbursement model with the farmer producer organizations. So your allegiance as a partner institution is not towards JSW Foundation, but more towards that farmer producer organization. And this is a model which I think I had worked when I was with UNIDO in cluster development program for almost like 7 to 8 years while I was with UNIDO across the length and breadth of the country. We tested this model quite successfully. Since it was largely around MSME development, therefore, you know, the level of, I would say, capacity of these institutions to, you know, take benefit from these BDS providers, that same model we are trying to do here with these FPOs to begin with women self-help groups to begin with, but slowly and steadily we are trying to see how even health and education kind of programs can be aligned in such a manner that, you know, the evaluation would not be just dependent upon our own assessment, but it would be done largely by the communities themselves. It's a long way, but I think we are moving in that direction.
Very interesting model, you know, Ashwini, and, you know, I hope you find success in it. You know, that's that was a very interesting insight there. I'd like to ask, you know, go you know, Balaji, you know, Balaji, if, you know, companies are now balancing, you know, as Ashwini also mentioned, between, you know, their own philanthropic and CSR intent and the law. So do you feel that impact assessment is a tool which, you know, if it gets into the law, and I think the draft rules have, you know, now, you know, instated a a potential mechanism that if you have a spend over 5 crores, then impact assessment is required and you need to disclose it. I mean, do you think this is going to create a tick in the box approach, or do you think is this something which is positive for the corporate return?
Good question. So I would say that evolved corporates that have been, you know, building CSR into their way of life and way of working, they've taken this for granted, right? They've already got this going. So whether it's just so many companies that I know of, including our own, that we've had evaluation as part of the whole journey from day one, irrespective of whether it's there in the CSR Act or not. And again, when we you know, work with world-class you know, independent consultants, including yourselves or whether it's KPMG or others, you guys in any case bring in that perspective from day one, saying, look, this is what the gold standard is now for CSR initiatives, and that includes without doubt the entire process of impact assessment. And so for a lot of organizations, it's a given. It's been a given for many years. For them, it does not matter. But the more and more you kind of make that visible to new organizations that have embarked on the journey more recently, because they're new. There's so many fast-growing organizations. You know, the more you share that knowledge with them, the more the best practices shared, the more it'll be embedded. Otherwise, what you said is that even if it was there in the act, if it becomes a tick in the box, then it's no good. If it's part of a journey that people believe makes them get better social impact and that they're accountable for their impact to the larger community, then it gets embedded and therefore it has better impact. That's my response to your question.
Great, great. Thank you so much for that, Balaji. I'd like to move to Sandeep now. And Sandeep, if typically you get a program audit, Sandeep, and you are sitting in front of the board, right? You get both social findings and financial findings. How as a CFO, I mean, facing the CSR committee and the board, how do you balance between the social outcome and findings in an audit and the financial outcome and findings?
So I think the financial propriety part of the evaluation is, like, I would say, table stakes, and that is absolutely essential. We would not like to work with a partner where there is even an iota of doubt about the financial integrity. And that's some amount of work that you do during the onboarding of these partners. And, as I look back at our last 5-year journey, it's been something that has been born out of necessity. When we were looking at areas where we wanted to spend money, we could easily go to very large organizations, very large implementation partners with so much repute, funding from all over the world, that maybe there was no need to do any due diligence there. But the only challenge with going and working with a very large NGO or a partner was that they had huge overheads. So, as a result, if you spend 100 rupees, only 20, 30 rupees would reach the beneficiary. And, 50, 60, 70 rupees was somewhere lost in overheads and, something which you could not verify the impact of. So, as a matter of choice, we said that we need to work with the guys who are closest to the beneficiary rather than working through an intermediary who maybe speaks our language and, is very close to us, to get maximum bang for the buck for our program size. Better to work with a implementation partner which is closest to the beneficiary. Now, when we did that, we figured out that these partners had very poor processes and systems. They were actually like sons of soil. They will speak the local language. Here we are used to PowerPoint, some presentation, some fancy slides. These guys don't have PowerPoint. They will have maybe a Word document, maybe something which is not written in the best English. So we said, well, if that is what will get us the maximum bang for the buck, then we must find a way of ensuring that we improve their governance processes, because it is all about education. My belief is a lot of mistakes are made because people who's doing it doesn't think he's doing a mistake. So it was all about transferring governance practices for either from us or from our advisors to these local implementation partners, and tell them that while it is important that you spend the 100 rupees that I give you behind the areas that you have committed to me, it is equally important. And maybe if there were to be a balance, I would say it would be 51 in favor of delivering the outcome more important than in making sure that every penny has, we are not doing an audit, and we are not reporting results of a listed company that we should be worried about a qualification by an auditor. We have to take a pragmatic call, be balanced. And if the end objective is satisfactory, then this is where you could say that the means would be, justified by the ends. So that's my perspective.
Wonderful. I didn't expect that of you, Sandeep. That's a very, very pragmatic and very practical view, and I, you know, and that's you know, that's really good to know. You know, that you're you know, that is your view. So that's fantastic. Arun, when we now look at you know, your perspective, what do you think makes up a quality impact assessment, Arun? I mean, you know, and what do you feel are the most critical elements, and you know, what are the key challenges? I mean, is it, like you mentioned, the theory of change? Is it data collection, sampling size, etc.? So what in your view, you know, are the, you know, the most critical elements to kind of focus on, and what are the key challenges of actually conducting something which is of quality?
Yeah, Rohit. So I think in what I have seen, that the biggest challenge which any impact assessment or for any kind of midterm or end term basically has, that you need to be clear that what your program intended to achieve. So when I said in my first opening remark, the question zero, if you know, if the your team or the NGO team know very clear cut that they, what is their question zero, if they have an idea on that, I think the rest things starts falling in place. But if I have to prioritize this and say after question zero, when your internal and external stakeholders are clear what you intended to achieve through your investment, and I call it CSR investment. I prefer to call that word, because when you have an investment, then you look at it in a more better way, approach that. Then I think the out challenge is that theory of change. I think your theory of change should clearly say that why you have done what you intend to do and how you have achieved that. Like, what are the conditions that had required to be fulfilled? So in my opinion, most of the assessment which is done are done kind of in a midway. And when the program might have started, these kind of clarity might not have been achieved, that what is that we want to achieve, the question zero, and what are the kind of processes and other things we will place to achieve those outcomes. So if those things we try to meet right from the beginning of the program, I think we will have a better outcome of an impact assessment. Also, one of the things I look at it, the biggest challenge is that the data collection part of it. Because since the clarity sometimes is not there, and after say 2 or 3 years, we realize that we need to do have an impact assessment, then we start going back and have data collections. That sometimes doesn't serve the purpose, because you are not able to then collect a baseline and understand that how does your end line has translated into the result. So it is important that before we start any program, there has to be a kind of a better assessment and dialogue with the not-for-profit partner to clarify that what you want to do it, how you want to do it, and then have a need assessment and a baseline. If these critical kind of a pieces we are able to ensure, I think the most of the challenges are addressed, and we could have a better result of outcome. And also maybe, Rohit, to outline that why you are doing this impact assessment. I think most of the time, if you go to the not-for-profit partner and say that you want to do impact assessment, they basically start kind of getting nervous, because they look at it that it's basically a kind of a fault finding or something like that. So if you are able to clarify that impact assessment or any kind of assessment is a learning tool, which will not only kind of benefit the organizations, the corporate, but also the NGO partner, I think you will have a close cooperation of doing that assessment. So if you ensure these critical pieces, I think your impact assessment will go well, and you will be also able to take some actions, because it's very important that you can do something but not take any actions, because it's very good as a kind of a 100 pages document and not go through it and start reflecting it and start introspecting to incorporate it. So you need to always revisit it and make it as a kind of a learning document.
Great. So I think that was very, 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 very useful, Arun. Thank you for that. I'll move on now to the COVID kind of pandemic, and, you know, to try and get your views, you know, on, you know, if there has been any change, you know, from a management perspective. So I'll pose that question to you, Ashwini, first, and do you think that the environment that we are in will change, the perspective of both the priority to do these exercises, and how do you think it will change in the, the manner in which you actually, will actually conduct this?
Rohit, we are actually facing this challenge, as I'm sure you must be aware of. We are in the middle of some assessments, and it's becoming a big challenge, how to complete some of those things. I think, yes, with COVID, the tools that we had been using for assessments so far will have to be redefined. I think that's surely a requirement. But at the same time, I think I would fully echo what Mr. Arun said or what Mr. Balaji said. The necessity of assessments would not go away. In fact, now that we have very specific things to look after, and there is very little window of opportunity, to deliver back to the communities, it's even more important to make sure that whatever we do is done in the right manner and it reaches to the people in the right way. So I think in terms of assessments, it will not go away, but in terms of how that assessment needs to be taken care of, I think that certainly would have to be looked at. And in terms of the importance of assessments, assessments would always remain important if we go back and share these reports with the stakeholders themselves. Even the organizations like, and I fully agree with what Arun just touched upon, that if we go with this lens of telling that where what has gone wrong and what needs to be improved upon, then I think under COVID circumstances, even the organizations are grappling with how to reach out and provide their services. So while for health, yes, there are certain opportunities, but education, yes, there are large number of innovations which are required. And at each location, I can tell you in my discussions with the local teams, they're coming up with some unique solutions to do that. So the partner organizations themselves are innovating. So obviously then my assessment tools also would have to be taking that into consideration. And therefore, yes, while the importance of assessments will not go away, but our lens of what is it that we really need to assess at this moment during this window, I think that's certainly going to undergo a change. And it has to be an iterative and I would say mutually agreeable process. Then only it makes sense.
Absolutely. Thanks for that, Ashwini. And Sandeep, I'd like to hear your views on this. So, it's really the... the same question for you, but do you agree with Ashwini? Do you have any different views, etc.? So it'll be really nice if you can share that.
So I think in the context of COVID, obviously all of us have had to adjust and adapt, and we've adjusted and adapted in I would say. Maybe two or three ways. First, of course, the whole focus for our CSR outlay in the first, my guess is 6 months, has totally changed because there is no way we can spend behind what our intended objectives are. There is no way you can, put 30 youth in one room and do some kind of skill development training. So obviously we've had to reorient the focus of our spend, and I think about 90% of what we would have spent in the first quarter has all been around COVID. So around supporting local communities, initially maybe with PPEs, and then as we changed our focus in trying to do something more sustainable around healthcare, but all around the COVID type of healthcare that would be required. Obviously, how you onboard a new partner in these times, a lot of the physical due diligence certainly cannot be done. But yes, word of mouth helps. Digital certainly helps. So we've had many interactions digitally with the various NGOs and implementation partners. And quite honestly, everybody has been very quick to adopt technology. It's not very complicated either. So work has continued. They've been able to, share with us photos, videos of all the work that they have done, which gives us a lot of assurance that indeed, yes, work has happened on ground. So we have parked all our initiatives around skill and water because it's not possible to do that, and we have kind of refocused all our resources behind supporting COVID. And I think 100% of all our interventions have been supported by technology with digital. Yeah, that's all I had. Thanks.
Great, Sandeep. It's quite amazing to see how a lot of things we've been able to manage to do, but with a little tweak. And I think we are also, you know, sort of, you know, fast learning how to, you know, adapt some of these changes. So before we, you know, head to the, you know, the wrap up question on the way forward, and I know technology is very close to, you know, Balaji's heart, and they've worked a lot on, you know, on technology. Before that, I'll pose one question, you know, to Arun, and then over to, you know, Balaji for, you know, the way forward. So Arun, you had mentioned, you know, some of the challenges of impact assessments, Arun, and do you foresee that these challenges will continue to remain, or they've actually deepened? And can you share with us if you see if there are any emerging trends or any innovations, especially in the manner of how one can actually conduct some of the evaluations, so that the donors or, you know, yourself, or, you know, people like Balaji, Ashwini, and Sandeep, you know, are comfortable, that the studies have, you know, maybe perhaps without field visits, have continued to, you know, give the same confidence to you as a donor.
Yeah, so few things, Rohit, on this from my perspective. One thing, if you look at the landscape of any country, say like India, or for that matter, say Africa or other parts, there is a big digital divide. There is a big digital divide. What essentially this means for a development programs? So this means that some will get less and some will get more, because if the digital divide is very high. If you look at that again from a development perspective, not all programs can be run virtually. So you have two kind of challenges, that not all programs can be run virtually. There is a digital divide, and that digital divide will basically translate that some will get more, some will get less. Now, how this will all translate into a development programs? This will translate that there is a variable program quality. Like what program quality you could ensure pre-COVID, now there will be a challenges during the COVID era. So in terms of how it will impact, how it will basically go ahead with the impact assessment. So if you look at for any impact assessment, I think a lot of the organizations, or for internal monitoring, a lot of organizations have been relying on a kind of a physical travel, interacting with the program participants, interacting with the not-for-profit partners. And that is going to change. So it will change, I think, something for better, and something might not be for better. Say for an example, you might have a more personalized approach when you are planning to do an assessment. You might not meet in a group of say 20 people, where only two people will speak and 18 will not speak. You are going to meet now with two people, at least two can speak, because there are some people who are very comfortable in speaking in a smaller groups. So in a way, you are going to get a lot of better information. You are going to get a lot of better input about your programs from those people who might have experienced or might not have experienced. Now, how that is going to translate in terms of the challenges, that, you know, because you will not be traveling to that locations, and there will be kind of, you know, possibility that it might be delayed, then you have to rely more of your not-for-profit partners team. You might rely on, if you have organizations working like a not-for-profit have a team on the ground. Now, on that challenge, I think there are a lot of work is happening on the digital divide, digital space. There are some organizations which are trying to create some kind of apps, which will basically feed in informations right from the beginning. So if you are at any places, you can access those informations that if the kids went to school or not, if you did an agriculture program, whether the farmer harvested a crop or not, if he harvested, how much price realization he got. So in any challenges, I think there are innovations and there are innovations happening, but it is not that these innovations are happening only because of COVID. What COVID might have done, it might have accelerated those innovations. It might have kind of forced a lot of organizations to use that innovations so that they can have a regular contact of the program and also assess the measurement and impact on the ground.
Great, Arun. I think that was that's actually gearing us up, you know, for the new normal. So Balaji, the floor is yours. These are the closing comments. What is the way forward? I mean, I know technology is really important. So more than ever, I think we need to go digital. What are your views?
I think Arun, Sandeep, and Ashwini have really responded already in a very, very compelling bunch of arguments they've given and way forward they've suggested. Maybe just a couple of points I'll add before, at least saying my closing comments. First and foremost, in some cases, I'm sure for most of the organization, there's no going back to the old ways. There is a new normal even in the social sector and in the social impact projects that all of us will embark on. That's an important learning. The point that Arun made on acceleration, absolutely a given. These tools are available. We suddenly figured out that, oh God, there is no other way but to embrace them very, very strongly and openly. Third is, I think the conversation on starting to think digital, I think that's a point that Sandeep made. Ashwini had echoed that earlier. Is about the whole thing that now programs have to be designed with digital in mind, digital delivery in mind. A lot of us and our programs are now focused on app-based delivery, portal-based delivery. There are a lot of tools available with the proliferation of broadband networks on the wireless side. So while earlier you might have looked at PC as the way of delivery, now we're saying mobile only as the way of delivery, not even mobile first, mobile only as a way of delivery. So we are now using YouTube channels to deliver a lot of our training material because smartphones are significantly more penetrated today than before. Yeah, we're using for data collection Google Forms. So literally we are saying use available tools of other tech players, other organizations, that we therefore design with mobile only in mind, for example. That's something that we find very useful. And therefore, the level of engagement that we now have with our, the beneficiaries. So in an education program, their beneficiaries, which are teachers, and of course the students. And now we're able to get a lot more impact because suddenly we've been able to make that happen in a very, very seamless manner. And so the impact is more, yes, sure. Unfortunately, there are pockets where there is an issue of digital haves and have-nots. There, clearly, we are having extension programs. Suddenly, we've started to look at hub-and-spoke models where we have, in one particular case, a van, which we have tied up with the CSE, the Common Services Center of the Métis thing. And suddenly, we're using the CSE guy as a potential trainer with a van that goes on predefined routes, because unfortunately there are places that there is no none of these digital end devices like a smartphone or a PC, and these guys are able to reach out there and then be able to propagate the program itself. So a mix of hybrid models will start to emerge. A lot more innovation will start happening now in the social impact and social project space, and the learnings that we are taking in the last 4 months and probably next few, as we conclude the entire unlocking process, will lead us richer on program design, on program measurement, and program course correction. I think that would be my summary. And I think technology is a great tool and a tool for that particular purpose.
Thank you so much for that. And, thank you, everyone. I'll request my colleague, Abhishek, to actually consolidate some of the questions on the chat box. I think we have about 5-7 minutes, Abhishek, so we can proceed with a few questions.
Yes. Okay. Am I audible?
Yes. Yes, you are.
Okay. Perfect. I have captured 5 questions. 4 of them are specific to one of the panelists, and there is one question which is open for all. So I'll just put up my document, and you can take up question at a time. And
so great. I mean, whoever wants to start, the questions on the screen.
I think I have a very simple question to be answered. So let me begin. I think, when you talk about impact, I think it's very important that anything that you measure during the project duration is never the impact. Whatever you measure during the project duration is just an outcome. The impact is both having two components, the intended impact and the unintended impact. And so obviously it has to be measured only when your program is over. So therefore, any short-term assessment that we do for a year of disaster or whatever, I think given the resilience of humankind, there is no necessity to measure a program's impact just because of this duration of COVID. I think it's a small outlier, and it needs to be just put aside, if you ask me personally. And the second part, which you are mentioning, that because of not being able to attend school for 1 year, it has a significant impact on loss of productivity. I think it's not because of education, if you ask me, or rather lack of education. It's because of a number of other factors, which are, I would say, psychosomatic, which actually impact a child in a distressed environment. And which has a much larger long-term impact on the child's ability to comprehend and, to come out of those, I would say, fears or apprehensions or whatsoever, which kind of affects the productivity to some extent. But saying that just because you've not been able to go to school for 1 year, it is going to create catastrophe for the entire life, henceforth, I don't think so. It's the right approach to look at it. So yes, impact is important to be measured, but on a short-term duration, impact would not be giving you any clear indications. I think that's the way I would like to answer this question.
Thank you, Ashwini. I think you just took the pressure off some of us by going first. Great questions. And I will just say, for the one which is addressed to me, it is like this. Investment is not necessarily monetary or the investment in a project for the end beneficiary thing. But clearly, we are very particular on transparency. We hold ourselves accountable for every rupee that we spend. And therefore, to that extent, it's just not assessment, but the whole the domain, the way you kind of want to the project design, the entire stage is a co-creation process for us. And clearly, if that meets, right from design to impact assessment, to the whole journey, that's where we get into an investment in terms of an association. If that doesn't, then I'm sure there are others who are going to invest in NGOs that we don't necessarily find at this point of time the ability to engage with or invest in. So it depends upon vision to design to assessment and everything being done transparently in a co-creation methodology. That is important for us.
So, so first of all, thank you, Abhishek. I think this is a very important question for, and I look at it in a very different approach, this question. So first, let me tell you, in terms of SROI, of course, if I have to answer into yes or no, of course, SROI does very well outline the impact of your program. But then, as all organizations, we plan to invest in CSR programs under, serve the most people where it's needed. Is SROI the only criteria to decide where you want to invest? I think that questions within each organization needs to be answered differently, because there will be some programs where SROI result might not be much higher, but those might be the most needy area. or those might be the most deserving area. So I would say while you decide to invest in your CSR programs or development programs, don't base your investment only just because of SROI. Now, SROI, of course, give you a good result that how your investment is translating into the impact on the ground. You are able to understand that which are the area where you need to accelerate, which are the area where you need to decelerate, but also look at SROI in a more holistic way. I think sometimes the chances are that we look SROI just only in terms of numbers. Rather than looking at a number, it should be looked at it where we are investing, how we have invested, and what result it has given so that we can further advance our programs.
Arun, can I just make one comment in addition to what you so wonderfully put together?
Yes, sir, please.
Yeah. So I mean, compliments, because you put it in the right perspective. You know, I think there's a lot of confusion when people say SROI is about impact measurement. I mean, SROI is basically telling you that if you put 2 rupees in health, it will give you a return of say 1.75 rupees. If you put in 2 rupees in education, it will give you a return of 2 rupees 15 paisa. If you put in that 2 rupees in say a livelihood program, it has given you a 5 rupees kind of a return. So it only gives you a comparative analysis between the cost benefit ratios of different programs that you've done. And that reminds me of a very fantastic tool. And I would urge many people who are interested in that to go onto the International Finance Corporation's IFC's website. And there is this tool called the Financial Valuation Tool, which basically talks about this only, that, you know, at different time horizons, in different contexts, at different stages of a program, what is it that you really want to do? And Arun, hats off, because you really said it so nicely that, you know, while the livelihood program or typical skill development program may be giving you a positive return as a cost benefit analysis, but is that the most important program to be done at this stage? I think that's the question that needs to be answered. So that's a very wonderful financial valuation tool available on IFC's website. I was a part of the team which worked on that. I would urge many of you to have a look at it, which gives you a comparison as to how this program that you're delivering is attached to your risk measurement portfolio, risk management portfolio, and how it is going to give you different kind of returns at different stages of your project. And that would therefore, you know, tell you when to do what, rather than just measuring the impact of a particular.
Excellent points. Only one point more I'll add is the sustainability. When you stop that intervention, does the whole cycle, the virtuous cycle, continue or not? I think that's the other part that I just want to add.
Sure, sure. So we've not really changed any matrices basis which we evaluate any of our implementation partners. We haven't really felt the need. Quite honestly, most of the work that we were doing pre-COVID is now kind of at a standstill. So there's no need, there's no work that the partner has done, and neither have we felt, of course, the need to change the matrices. All that has changed in this period is the activities or the areas where we have spent money, and by and large, the technology using through which we have interacted with the implementation partner and the kind of, you know, evaluation that we have done, which has been digital. So I mean, just to answer your question, no real change for now. We will take a call maybe 6-9 months later.
And any comments on the last question, like how do we make an outlay on the social audits?
Yeah, so maybe I can take that and see. So in terms of social audit, you know, Abhishek, one of the things we have to understand that do we have a competency to do a social audit? I think social audit is also a very specialized way of how you facilitate the community process to assess your program impact. And most of the times, you know, people say that let's do the social audit, but each organization needs to bring certain expertise and experience in doing that. Of course, if you want to make a you know, provision in budget for social audit, you can do it, because ultimately it's a part of assessment of your program directly from the program participants, that how this program has benefited and how this program has translated into that benefit. But social audit, one of the key requirements is that the competency, and also right from the beginning, you have to ensure that everybody was involved in the planning and the development of the program and also in monitoring. Otherwise, social audit will not give you a result what you want to understand. The chances are that the social audit might give way more area of improvement than a kind of a progress and project plan.
Okay, great. I think we've made to the time as well. Thank you so much. Once again to all the panelists. I'm extremely grateful, and I think the conversation surpassed all our expectations. I think we all had a great time. Wonderful views. Thank you, Arun. Thank you, Ashwini. Thank you, Balaji, and thank you, Sandeep, who's just joined or just logged off. And thank you for all the participants. And I'm really excited to do this again. So I think we should have a part two. I think there is still much more to be discussed, on this topic. So thank you on behalf of Content once again. Thank you so much.
Thank you.